Get in the water trough. Okay. Okay. Feeding pigs, checking water, checking cows. It's a big part of my life this time of year. And as I'm down here looking at the water, I've decided, you know, I don't really need this hot wire down here anymore. The reason that I put this up is because when I first put the cow sprayer out, I noticed some cows were avoiding walking through it because they were just getting in the ditch here to get some water. But now we've got them broke to it, so we really don't need this anymore. In fact, we're just keeping them out of a lot of good feed. Now I'm looking at the box. The ground wire is not even hooked up. It got bumped off somehow, some way down the road, but they've been respecting the wire this whole time. So I don't know how to feel about that. Good, I guess. Why stand when you could lay? Man, that one's in there. There it is. That'll stay on there. Maybe not. I've said it before and I'll say it again. Having a portable hot wire setup like this is a complete game changer. So what's the plan for today? Well, we're gonna go around, take care of all the things that we have to do, and then see how much time is left for the things that I would like to do. That's what's going on today on Farmer Tyler Ranch. We're over here at the steer pasture and it is steer moving day, which also means it's sprinkler fixing day. Fortunately, this time there was only one busted one. I've already fixed it. You guys have seen me do that 1,000 times. And if you've seen it once, you've seen it 1,000 times. And I catch myself because for the first 2 years we brought cattle here, I only brought steers. So this became known as a steer pasture, but now we've got 3 heifers and one of our bulls up here as well. So calling it the steer pasture isn't really accurate because there are not only steers here, but old habits die hard. And I've tried calling it the summer pasture. I've tried calling it the yearling pasture. None of those stick. We're going with steer pasture. Come, boss. Come, boss. Well, I don't know. They all ran about halfway to me and stopped there in the shade. I bet if I walk over the hill here to where they can't see me anymore, they'll come up here looking for me. I can't see them now, but I assume they're coming. Oh yeah. Okay, they're coming. You gotta stay ahead of them. Sometimes they get excited and they start running and they might miss the gate down here, but if I'm kind of standing by it, then that, I don't know, seems to help. As they say, there's one in every crowd, and I guess he is it. Come on, dude, you know where this gate is. This guy's always a friendly one, aren't you? These guys are looking better. Pink eye is not nearly the issue it was about a month ago, but like the bull got it. He's healing up on his own now. And then there's one more out here. I think it was actually one of the ones that I had with a patch on him that is just healing a little bit more slowly. And I've also noticed that the fly pressure is not nearly as bad as what it was a little while ago. For a while, I was thinking I needed to come bring a back rubber down here, and now I'm not so sure. They don't really have a lot of flies on them, and I'm not sure what happened. But like the pink eye, it's something we'll be keeping an eye on. Well, we're back home now, and it's hot, but the show must go on. One thing that I've been needing to do also is get this larger pig pen area set up so that I can release the piglets out of the house here and give them access to this whole run. Really, they got plenty of room in there at this size, but when you have them confined like that, the flies get a lot worse than they would be if they were just roaming around out here. So we got to do this eventually anyway, and I think we're gonna kind of be mostly in the shade, so seems like a good day to do it. There's really only two things that have to happen to where I can let them out here. One of them's real easy, and that's turn their water on. And I even got them a new hose. See if that's gonna work and or leak. No leaks on that end. And I don't see any on this end. Might have been why it wasn't leaking. There was a big air bubble there. It works. So we must have had a big air bubble there at the end at the nipple, because I see the hose is dripping now. I'm not sure how worried I am about that, because as the pigs use this water nipple, they will inevitably create a big puddle here, so having another little drip is probably not going to be noticeable. But maybe if we can fix it, we will. Might have to go get some channel locks to really get that tight. Yeah, that might have done it. The other thing is that the water out here is so hard, if you just got a little drip like that, it usually plugs itself after a little while. The other part of this equation, which is going to take a little bit more time, and that's getting the hot wire all put back together and functional again. I think it's all still here, but it's maybe buried, maybe broken, maybe who knows. We just gotta go through it, find it, figure it out. Is part of it. We got it, but it feels awfully loose. I suspect it's probably broken down here somewhere. Still in that post. Well, as I'm walking through here, I'm finding that most of this wire is not in the mud, but there's a ton of dry grass out here that it is all buried in, and like where I want the wire to be, it's just that. So what I'm thinking now is maybe what I want to do is just not take the wire down, but lift it up high enough to where the pigs wouldn't even be able to touch it, and turn them out here for a little while so that they can eat all this grass, knock all this down, because that's exactly what they'll do. They're pigs. And then once they kind of get the fence line cleaned up, lower the wire back down and then turn it on. If this wire is in all of this tall grass, it's not going to really work that good anyway, because every place grass touches it is like a little ground rod. Now let's just let the pigs clean this up. They're real good at that. And then once they get it cleaned up, I can lower that wire back down. And we should be all good. Now I gotta find the other end of it. That ought to be fun. Boy. You know, this panel's been stuck in the ground for probably a couple years at this point. I've never been able to get it out, and I don't know. Today, it just worked. I've got the other end of the wire over here against the house. Watch out, Kelly. Oh, looks like we got some rats. So it's right here. Hopefully we can just pull it up. Okay, this actually should not be as hard as I was afraid it might be. If I've already got a fence here, then why do I need hot wire? Well, the problem that I've had in the past is that the pigs get to rooting around along the fence, and then they end up just kind of rooting their way right underneath of it. This problem is made far worse by the ground being wet. So if you notice, the pig pen goes right up against our yard that I irrigate with sprinklers. And when I do that, it's almost impossible to not get the ground wet right along this fence. And in addition to that, what I'll often do is shoot a sprinkler into the pig pen and kind of aim it to hit right in the middle to create a mud wallow for them so that they've got somewhere to lay and cool off. But when you do that, the ground right where the sprinkler is shooting over the fence gets wet, and they oftentimes find their way underneath of that as well. If you've never raised pigs before, bear in mind that they are destructive, and sometimes you can use that to your advantage. Like if you do like we do and put them out in your garden at the end of the year, and they'll till the ground up for you and do all that. But when you're making a pen for them, you got to keep that in mind and try to prevent any potential issues. And I have learned that the hard way over the years. So now I'm going to try to establish a wallow for them right here in the middle of the pen where I want them to have it. It seems like what always happens, and I'm sure will probably happen again, is they just end up digging a big hole right where the water nipple is, right next to the fence, which causes problems throughout the year. So I'm hoping if I can sort of establish this as the spot that you go to cool down, that, you know, maybe they'll kind of stick with that through the year. I've had this hose running for a while, probably 15, maybe 20 minutes, and the ground is just drinking it up, but I think that there should be pretty good mud here once they find it, and I would be willing to bet if I pull the hose away, you could just watch that water soak down into it. So we'll see. I don't know. I don't want to run this for too long. It just kind of seems like a waste of water, but it'll be something where, you know, maybe 10 minutes every day, I just got to come out and keep this wet for them. Well, let's open the gate and see what they think about all this. That always seems to make them happy. You know, odds are this is the most free space they've ever had. And you can tell they kind of don't know what to do with it right at first. I did notice they all walked by the water nipple and not a single one of them got a drink. So I think what I should do, boy, this would be perfect if one can see me do this. You guys see that? That's where your water is now. all those pigs just saw me use the water nipple, and I think they're smart enough to kind of understand, not to mention the fact that the pen we bought them out of, they were drinking out of a water nipple, so they should know what that is already. But I just kind of like to make sure that they know where it is so that they can find it. If you're dealing with pigs that have never seen a water nipple before, then what I will usually do is take their pan that they've been drinking out of and put it right next to the water nipple, and then always try to kind of keep it wet. You know how you saw me spill that out on the ground? Well, pigs aren't dumb. They'd know that there's moisture there, there's water there, and they'll start hunting around until they figure out where it came from. They also kind of naturally just chew on everything, put their mouths on everything. So in a smaller pen, they'll just find it on their own. But in a bigger pen like this, I like to try to give them a little bit of direction. Well, they don't seem too impressed with the wallow that I tried to make for them, but I guess there's a lot of new things they got to go around and check out. So I, you know, we'll just leave them to it. This is their home now. We'll let them get settled in, get used to it, go and sniff and chew on everything, just like a pig's got to do. Back over here at the ranch now, and it's hot. And if you don't believe me, just ask them. You know, for a long time, I thought, man, the grass really grows out here when it's hot like this. And I'm sure that it does. But it kind of dawned on me this year that maybe the reason why it seems like the grass is getting so tall when it's hot like this is because in the middle of the day, the cattle are up here hiding in the shade, not out there eating it. A couple videos ago, I told you guys that I was pretty sure I had another cat living in the barn here. And I was going to bring my trail camera down to put it on the dish to see what we've got. I never even gave that another thought that day, but I did give it a thought today. I filled this up the other day. You could see a fair amount's been eaten out of it. I don't think there's enough missing here that would suggest there's multiple cats in the barn or wild animals that are just devouring this stuff, but there's at least one, I would say. One of something, hopefully a cat, but we're gonna find out. Well, I'll be curious to see what we catch on that. I thought I saw a black cat, so we'll see. The bad thing is that you guys won't get to see what I catch in this video. You'll have to wait till the next one. Well, it's getting a little bit later in the day and it's too hot to start a new project, but I did kind of want to show you guys what's coming down here. I think I have finally settled on a design that I'm happy with, or a plan of how I want to build this, and it checks all of the boxes, I think. So you guys know I've been complaining about these portable panels down here. They're flimsy, they're lightweight, they're just, I don't really have a good thing to say about them. I guess they have served their purpose for what I needed them to do, but I've just been griping about it the whole time. So I have finally decided how I think I want to improve this area, get a permanent fence set up in here that is strong, yet still leaves me access to my squeeze chute and still gives me a good gateway to go back into the tub. The new layout is gonna be roughly the same. It's just gonna be stronger and better. And it's gonna start with, I don't have all the measurements committed to memory yet, so just kind of bear with me. But this panel here will be a gate. It'll be like 8 or 9 feet, and when you open it this way, it'll come right to the edge of the AeroQuip chute. When you open it around the other way, it will latch to a post that is right next to the barn. Post that this gate is going to hang on will be roughly where this T-post is, probably not exactly, but in this vicinity. And when the gate is open against the chute, like the position that the panel is in now, there's not going to be a latch or a catch for it here anywhere. I thought about maybe doing something down at ground level that could catch the gate, but I was just afraid that I would end up tripping over it. And I didn't want to put a post right here next to the chute. It makes it harder to remove, and it also could interfere with the head gate. So it's really, in my opinion, better to leave this open and just kind of have this gate hang here while it's in this position. But That could also be problematic because when the cattle are going back into the tub, if they turn around and bump this with their hip, it would just swing into this area and then they would now be able to get in there, which we don't want. So the plan that I came up with was on this post, we'll do a little diagonal foot that comes off of it and then back down. So it'll come out on, I would say, the way I'm envisioning it now, a 45 degree angle to the ground, and then it'll be cemented in the ground as well. So that this gate, when it opens to this point, hits that diagonal brace and cannot open any further. This actually solves two problems because this post was gonna go up, have a cross brace on top that met to the post that's right against the barn, so that when the gate is closed this way, it's got somewhere to latch, and then the two posts are tied together, so the gates just makes everything stronger that way, obviously. But what was gonna end up happening is that this gate frame here was just gonna be freestanding, which I'll get into a little bit more in a minute. So putting this diagonal brace on here is actually gonna help strengthen all this and keep it from moving. So the gate post is where that T-post is. The next permanent post is gonna be down here 12 or maybe 13 feet away from the original post. Now why 12 or 13 feet? Because then that will still give me enough room to pull the AeroQuip chute out of here if I ever need to do it. I'm not sure why I ever would, but I would rather plan for that now than have to go through and cut a bunch of pipe and pull posts out. It's a lot easier to just plan for it now. So in our 13 foot gap here, my plan is to take some angle iron and weld it to the permanent posts on either side, and then use some of the square tubing that I salvaged from the alleyway to make a giant, super heavy, removable panel. This will be something that I won't be able to just like pick up and lift and carry away. It'll definitely be a tractor project to do it, but I figure as infrequently as this will ever have to happen, if it ever has to happen, that's an acceptable way to do it. After all, if I need to pull the chute out of here, I'm gonna have the tractor here with the forks anyway, so it won't be that big of a deal. My plan is to just bolt the removable panel to the angle iron there, and that should be plenty stout. Even with a 13 foot span, I think it's gonna be fine. Part of that is because we'll be using oil pipe to make it, which is very heavy itself. But the other part is my plan is to put paneling on this fence, whether that's plywood or sheet metal or whatever it might be. So when you eliminate that visual, they can't see through it, then it doesn't really register in their mind to like reach their head in there and try to push through it. So I don't really imagine they're gonna be messing with this too much. So we've got our gate post over there, 13 feet, we've got this post, and then I'm thinking maybe 4 feet we'll put another post, and I wanna put a man gate here because a lot of times I'm walking to and from the working area to the working corral, and I'm either having to climb over the fence or go around that gate, and it would just be a lot nicer to have a little man gate right here, like when I'm bringing the scale head or the vaccines or, you know, all that stuff in here. It would just be nice, and now's the time to do it. So 4 feet, another post, man gate, and then from that post, we should be able to weld the pipe into the existing square post. So this checks all of my boxes. It's gonna be much stronger. It's gonna be more convenient with the man gate. I'll still have access to the AeroQuip chute, or like if I wanna dump gravel in here, it might be nice to be able to remove the panel. Another thing that I would like to do is build some sort of a built-in table in here to put like my ice chest, syringes, whatever I'm using while I'm working. It would just be nice to have a permanent table that's up off the ground, and I'm not having to do like what I've been doing and, you know, flip a water trough over to put stuff on top of that. And just thinking out loud, because this is already gonna be so heavy, I don't really see any downside to just like welding the table to that, so that, you know, it'd be a little more awkward, but you're already lifting it up with the tractor, so I don't think it's really gonna matter at that point. Quick side note, look at little boy. I feel like he has just hit a growth spurt here in the last month or so. I saw him out here getting a drink the other day. I almost didn't recognize him. But, you know, I know there's only one black bull out here, so it had to be him. But, man, he looks like he is really growing. My big concern with this project, though, is that where I weld in my cross piece here and also the latch for the gate, I'll be doing a lot of welding right next to this barn. And as you know, this barn is full of hay for the following year. The odds of a spark getting in there and starting a fire are probably not very high, but there are a lot of holes in this tin. There's crevices where the tin overlays each other. I do not want to do any welding next to the barn here. I don't even want to do any welding over here if it's a little bit windy. So I think what that is going to mean is that this gate hoop anyway, I'm going to have to prefabricate that in the shop and then set these two posts at the same time. So that's probably going to require a tractor, maybe my three-point lifting arm to kind of hold everything, get it all squared up where I want it. So that's gonna be a little bit of a challenge. I've never done it that way before, but it's just gonna be something that I'm not quite used to. I've got plenty of pipe for this project. I got the concrete the other day, so really the only thing stopping me is all the other things that I feel like I need to get done first. Harvesting chickens being probably at the top of that list. But I don't know about you, I would definitely rather have way too many things that I need to do than sit around and be bored. Thanks for hanging out with me today, guys, and I hope I'll see you again on Farmer Tyler Ranch.